Welcome to the Talbot Rice Gallery for the first of this year's Café des Artists series of evening discussions hosted by the Artists Research Partnership in collaboration with the Talbot Rice Gallery. My name is Neil Cox, I'm the director of the Artists Research Partnership, and you will have already been welcomed by legions of MSc interns who work on projects with me to deliver public events, research, discussion around the collection Artist Rooms. So, the Artist Rooms Research Partnership works in collaboration with Tate and National Galleries of Scotland to develop research around the Artist Rooms collection, which consists of work by 38 artists. There are about 1,600 works in the collection, and we've been working on this project now for over 4 years. This is the fifth year. If you want to find out about what we do, you can like our Facebook page, which is where you can find out about our forthcoming events. In fact, next week there's an event in the Scottish National Gallery of Modern Art working with newspapers on but we'll have more information about upcoming cafes and also our film screening program, Clips, which will launch again over in January, which was the first time we did that last year. It was really exciting and interesting, showing films that relate to or made by artists in the Artist Rooms collection. The collection, as you probably know, is based around the Anthony Gotley donation to the state and purchased the AD Art Fund and other partners. The collection is growing all the time, and it tours on a national basis in sort of monographic rooms. And it's that sort of monographic focus on the artists in the collection that is the basis of our discussions in the cafe, focusing on individual artists. So, what's going to happen this evening is we're going to have two talks from Mapplethorpe experts, and we are then going to have a break and set you some homework to discuss some ideas that have emerged from the talks. There are some useful prompts, takeaway postcards, Mapplethorpe postcards on the tables for you as well, and we'll come back together later to feedback and think about what's emerged on your tables in discussion. So, without further ado, I'm going to introduce our two speakers. They're going to speak probably for about 40 minutes or so, and then we'll have a break. So our two speakers are Susan McAteer, who works with Simon Groom, the director of the Scottish National Gallery of Modern Art, and before that was actually an MSc student in History of Art at the University of Edinburgh, and was an intern working on Artist Rooms, writing online summary texts. And actually, I think in this room there are some current online summary writers. Put your hands up. The tradition continues. So you can find some of Susan's entries on Mapplethorpe Works on the Tate website. And she's very excited to talk to us this evening about her interest in Mapplethorpe, and to have the opportunity to talk at greater length about him than she was able to do in the summer. Our second speaker is Fiona Anderson, who for a short period of time worked with us here in History of Art, and I've just about forgiven her for leaving us to go to the University of Newcastle. Many of you will know Fiona's work in the area of queer theory, and also that she is an exceptional speaker about a range of art from the 1960s and 70s. And she was an erstwhile speaker in another cafe on Dianarbus in Kirkcaldy, believe it or not. So I'm going to hand over to Susan now.
So as Neil mentioned, I interned with the Artist Rooms collection, and I wrote various summaries for Mapplethorpe Works. So writing for that kind of context, I had to follow certain guidelines with style and tone. So it is great to be here this evening to be able to kind of expand on my own thoughts and perspective on Mapplethorpe's work. So I'm going to start with a quote, which I find quite interesting from the artist himself. And he says, "The work is very direct. I try not to have anything in the picture that's questionable. I don't want anything to come in at an angle that isn't supposed to come in at an angle." So I think this particular quote is quite interesting because it seems as though the artist is deterring us from questioning his work or probing too much beyond the surface with it, which with art we're very compelled to do and having discussions such as we are tonight. So I thought that it would be interesting to consider an element of Mapplethorpe's work, which is quite surface and which is elemental, and that's why I'm going to look at light. And as you might have noticed from the first slide, I'm going to develop this idea of light as language throughout Mapplethorpe's work. Now, what actually drew me to exploring this theme is this particular image. This image always sticks out in my mind whenever I think of Mapplethorpe. And I think that it's not the most usual or most common representation of the artist. And I think that's one of the aspects that draws me to it. As you can see, it's bathed in light, and the artist seems very relaxed. His hair is tousled, there's this charming smile just forming on his face, and there seems to be no tension. His fingers lie but limply. And the kind of precision and perfection which we're used to in Mapplethorpe's work, it feels like it doesn't necessarily apply to this. So it's more of a hopeful, kind of youthful portrait, which is presented here with this steeped in light. Now, I'm going to look at this work here. Mapplethorpe attended the Pratt Institute in New York, and he studied drawing, sculpture, and painting. And he originally worked with a lot of sculptural objects and used a lot of images and photographs in these. And his source for this was mainly pornographic magazines. But as he went on, he got a bit frustrated in not finding what he was looking for in these magazines. So he started to take his own images to incorporate into them. So he started in 1970 with a Polaroid camera, and he used the Polaroid for about 5 years until he got a Hasselblad. Now, technically, the Polaroid camera is very limiting, so he was quite dependent on natural light for his work. And this was also a time before he had a dedicated space or studio, so again, he would be photographing in his own apartment or where he was staying at that time, or apartments of friends. So natural light was a very big factor. Now, this image here, Patty Smith is who this is of, and she was a lifelong friend of Mapplethorpe, and they lived together at various points in New York. And she was actually his most photographed subject after himself. And Smith wrote an autobiographical account of her relationship with Mapplethorpe, and it's called Just Kids. And she describes shooting this particular image, which is the cover of her first album, Horses. And this was shot in Sam Wagstaff's apartment. And Wagstaff was a kind of mentor and patron to Mapplethorpe, and also his lover. And they were together until Wagstaff died in 1987, which was about 2 years before Mapplethorpe himself passed away. Now, in this image, in her autobiography, Patty Smith has a really nice description of them taking the shot. She describes them running across town so that they wouldn't miss the natural light, and that Mapplethorpe had in mind a very particular corner of the apartment where a certain shadow would be cast. And she describes the scene as, "I had my look in mind, he had his light in mind, that was all. I flung my jacket over my shoulder, Frank Sinatra style. I was full of references, he was full of light and shadow." And actually there is an image in the artist room's collection, this one here, which is from the same shoot, but obviously the other one was used for the cover. And I do think this one actually is very interesting too, and mainly kind of compositionally with different diagonals and lines of the body, mirroring with the tie here. And I think with the story of that Patti Smith recounts of shooting that album cover, it brings light up as a technical issue, but it also transforms light into a very tangible thing. It feels like this tangible object. It's a thing which can be lost, and a thing which is very integral to Mapplethorpe's vision, in that he has a very specific spot in mind where a shadow can be cast. And I feel that this emphasizes that Mapplethorpe always had this consistency in his work. The vision was always there, as he said, and the light was always in mind. Now, I think that there is a duality to light, and this is on a linguistic level, but also in terms of art. It's elemental as well as a required property of the photographic process, and it infers and it creates meaning, and sometimes it can be several different meanings simultaneously. With Mapplethorpe's work, the visual is really the emphasis, and he kept images free of additional content, making sure that the focus was the intended subject. So by focusing on the surface, Mapplethorpe really used light to communicate visually. I'm going to look at two more categories in Mapplethorpe's work, and that is flowers and his nudes. So looking at this image, which is actually on your postcards as well, I think that with flowers, Mapplethorpe really used light to communicate this duality of this object. Because whenever we think of flowers, there's often a kind of association with them as vulnerable objects and quite delicate and transient. But the way that Mapplethorpe presents them, they take on different qualities. They feel more solid and strong and eternal. So in this particular image of the lily, it rears from the bottom right corner here, and it's lit so brilliantly that you can nearly mistake it for marble. And much of Mapplethorpe's work actually has this quite sculptural relatability. His images are orchestrated and deliberate and refined, and they feel a lot more in line with sculpture quite often, rather than other modes of photography, such as more documentative or candid styles. Now, the use of light is integral to the creation of these sculptural images. And in this particular work of the lily, where this kind of visual marble effect is perceived, there's a sense of conflict, as classically marble sculptures with their pure white form depict and embody a certain lightness. We imagine graceful figures with soft-rounded lines that appear light despite the solid weight and mass from the material which they're sculpted. This sculptural duality exists with this lily, the material and the medium conflicting to deliver opposing ideas. Janet Carden, who curated a very significant exhibition of Mapplethorpe's work titled The Perfect Moment, this is in 1988 in the Institute of Contemporary Art in Philadelphia. And she also referred to the linguistic quality of Mapplethorpe's flowers, particularly with the lily. And she stated that this is the flower that symbolizes the Madonna's purity. For Mapplethorpe, it represents a seductive, perhaps demonic antichrist. His lilies, like many of his other subjects, are intentionally bilingual. So the use of the word bilingual is interesting, as not only does Carden acknowledge a linguistic element in Mapplethorpe's visual representation, but she highlights the various meanings which can be drawn from the subject and image, so to the extent that another language can be identified to communicate a different meaning or idea. Another work which I feel creates a certain tension is this particular one of Baby's Breath. And Baby's Breath, I mean, the language of it, the connotation and its delicate nature, and as a complementary flower, it feels like all of these associations are dashed whenever we see this image with the stark composition and lighting. The white speckles of the flowers against the black background don't chime with these usual kind of thoughts about the flower, but instead create this kind of unease and really a menacing quality. And what I actually want to see here, it feels as though the baby's breath is like a mass of nerves or atoms, which serves as this reminder that it's very much a living thing. So the delicacy of the flower now feels assertive and very much present and by no means a complementary or insignificant object. And I think this is the great success of Mapplethorpe's flower images. He knew that nobody could photograph them the way that he did, and he attributed a certain weirdness to them, but the weirdness isn't necessarily articulated. So through the visual language of light, he presents a conflict which manifests on the surface and goes deeper to the questioning of the vulnerable and the sinister. So as I mentioned, I'm also going to look at some nude images of Mapplethorpe's. And I do say nude rather than naked, as in the history of art there is this distinction between nude and naked, and this is put forward by Kenneth Clark, the art historian, and he said, "To be naked is to be deprived of our clothes, and the word implies some of the embarrassment most of us feel in that condition. The word nude, on the other hand, carries in educated usage no uncomfortable overtone. The vague image it projects into the mind is not of a huddled, defenseless body, but of a balanced, prosperous, and confident body, the body reformed." This distinction is usually applied to painting and sculpture, but with photography is a relatively new medium, and especially one that in the 70s and 80s wouldn't have applied to the upper echelons of high art. The distinction really isn't as clear. And Arthur Danto, who was an American art critic and philosopher, noted that by formalist standards of critical appraisal that prevailed in museum and art historical circles until the most recent times, Mapplethorpe's work all by rights qualify as art at the highest level. The main way in which I think Mapplethorpe communicates these images as high art is through lighting. The fact that the lighting is so deliberate and clearly in a studio setting indicates that the subjects are nude rather than naked. The models aren't caught unawares, and there's an intention and agreement between photographer and subject. And the bodies do feel confident, and in Clark's words, the bodies feel reformed. The models are also always named in the titles, and the work removes any kind of anonymity if it's titled in such a way and proclaims this confidence as being nude. The exclusion of any unnecessary objects or setting also communicates that this is a nude and that this is the only thing that should really command our attention in the image. The content of the images can teeter on sexual, but the aesthetic is classical. This really harks to the heart of Mapplethorpe's work, which is this balance of tension. Now, Mapplethorpe photographed both white and black models, and sometimes they were photographed together or separately. And the first classical sculpture, we are more accustomed to seeing representations of the white figure. So for the artist to use black models and present them as high art, he's challenging the viewer on various levels. The figure is without clothing, the figure is black, and this isn't a photographic medium. So do any or all of these aspects make us question if this is high art? And quite late in his life, Mapplethorpe photographed sculpture also, and Danto suggested that this might have partly been because he was quite ill towards the end of his life, so with reduced mobility it would be easier to photograph static rather than live objects. And with these sculptures though, Mapplethorpe still treats them with the respect that he would a model or a living thing. And this respect is evident in the expertly executed lighting, which follows the consistency that he has with shooting the body. And this image of the sluggard has remarkable similarities to the previous image of Derek Cross here. I mean, the curve in the torso, the rippling muscles, the raised arms, the definition in the bodies between both this and the sculptural image, they feel both in tandem, and they feel like they've both been treated in a similar way with light. So I think that this really distinguishes all of Mapplethorpe's work, and how he really achieves this is through the language of light. So he also photographed black and white models together. And if we look at this on a purely visual level, we're really struck with this contrast of light and dark. The bodies have this harmonious connection, and while the limbs nearly physically combine, they're kept separate by that strong contrast of light and dark. In this image, he plays further with light, as we see the diagonals which sweep across their bodies. They appear more faded at the top and grow in definition as you move down the body. In this instance, light becomes a very visible element and aspect of the composition, and it becomes a very intended light, as it's very obvious that this is studio lighting that's being used. So, in order to present us with something visually new, Mapplethorpe takes the subject of two naked men with bodies mirroring the sinuous curve and takes it to this level of a visual pattern. It's removed from sexual or fetishized connotations. Mapplethorpe noted that the shock factor was never actually a driving or intentional force in his images, but that he wanted to create something new and something he hadn't seen before. And classically and aesthetically in art, black posed bodies were not very common. He hadn't seen black bodies portrayed like this before. And I do think that this is important to keep in mind whenever we're looking at this visually, because there is a temptation to delve into the political and social circumstances or questions that this might bring up. And it does make for a very interesting discussion. But on that purely visual level, we're seeing something that hadn't been seen before, and something which is visually and aesthetically stimulating. And going back to where I began, I started with this self-portrait of a younger Mapplethorpe with this bathed in light image. And I wanted to consider the alternative, which is the absence of light. In 1989, Mapplethorpe died at the age of 42 of AIDS. And prior to his death, his health had deteriorated very quickly, which impeded his work and made him appear a lot older than his years. So for this particular image, what he originally planned on doing was taking a photo just of the cane with the ornamental skull on top. But while he was preparing, he decided to put on a black turtleneck and actually make it into a self-portrait. And it was taken then by his younger brother, Edward, who's also a photographer. Now, in this image, Mapplethorpe appears gaunt and weathered, and it was taken just months before his death, and it feels quite evident. If you look at the image, you can see that his head is slightly more out of focus in relation to his hand in the foreground. So it gives this impression of this kind of nearly fading away, with prominence given to that skull, acting nearly as something of an omen. So with this, it feels like the black background is starting to envelop him, and the light is fleeting, but with this kind of confrontational, striking portrait, he asserts that he is very much still the master of it.
Thank you, Susan. So I'm going to be focusing then in my talk on the treatment of sex and sexuality in Mapplethorpe's work. And I'm going to focus on his relationship to gay, sadomasochistic sexual subcultures and his participation in those scenes. A lot of the works that I'm looking at, that were not initially intended for public view, but they became subjects of public discussion after they were censored, or after the Perfect Moment exhibition that Susan mentioned, when it was intended to go to the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C. But it became a subject of controversy following pressure from right-wing religious groups about the inclusion of the works that Mapplethorpe was best known for, and with some of his more private sadomasochistic images and his very innocent images of children and friends. So this kind of together formed this perfect storm that led to the censorship and the closure of that Perfect Moment exhibition when it was shown in Washington. So I'd like to think about Mapplethorpe's subjects that he uses in these images, his compositions, but also put his erotic work in context and think about the socio-political circumstances in which it was produced and that it speaks to. So Mapplethorpe photographs the state of masochistic sex cultures in 1970s New York. They operate in one sense as documentary photographs of a very particular sexual subculture, or what we might call a scene. And he met many of his subjects, this is of course a self-portrait, but he met many of these subjects in kind of the back rooms or dark corners of gay clubs and sex clubs and leather bars, many of the ones that were around the derelict piers on the Lower West Side of Manhattan in the late 1970s. But I think that the composition of his photographs of this, his treatment of the figures, both in terms of his handling of light and the way that, as Susan mentioned, he names his subjects quite casually, sitting clearly on first-name terms with them. But it suggests that there's actually something much more complex and I think much more interesting than documentation going on here. So in this image, for example, where we meet Dominic and Elliot, we see two men posed for the camera. They're performing for it. They're performing specifically for the act of being captured by the camera, rather than performing in front of it and being documented, or performing sexually and that being captured by the photographer. They're very aware then of being photographed, firstly. But secondly, I think they're both exhibiting power, both of them, in front of the camera's gaze. So then they suspend for a moment, quite literally, the top and bottom power dynamics of so much sadomasochistic or SM sex, so that they both dominate the frame, and because of the dominant position that both of them assume, they place us, the viewer, in the submissive position in this sexual dynamic. So as much as this is a photograph about sex and about a very specific sexual subculture, it's also, and this is something I'd like to explore with all of the photos I'll show just now, it's also a photograph about photography. So it's about the power relations between subject and object, between a viewer and viewed. And in this work, Jim and Tom Sausalito, I think we find ourselves, formally speaking, in a very similar situation, in a similar setting. We could call this one, I think, quite accurately dungeon-esque. And we watch submissively as a man urinates into another man's mouth. But again, this is another highly staged image. And it's also highly idealized because it's rendered in black and white. It allows Mapplethorpe to indulge his parallel interest in the play of light and shadow in this very dark underground space. So light reflects off leather incredibly well. It reflects off the stream of urine that flows from into Tom's mouth. And it enables bodies to be outlined very suggestively. They kind of appear almost multiplied by the shadow around them. The shadows start to form a kind of orgiastic situation. And we also see the way that the shadows of the ladder seem to sort of penetrate Jim from behind. But equally, the composition is very classicizing. Or we might view it in this particular situation as a triptych, as religiously suggestive. So this is partly because it's arranged with three images, like a traditional altarpiece might be, appropriating that traditional form. But also that leads us to kind of see the figure of Tom kneeling before Jim in a sort of supplicant position as well. I think that's really important, kneeling in supplication. We see a similar sort of staging in this work Brian Ridley and Lyle Heater from 1979. The composition of the work mimics a sort of traditional marriage portrait. And the art historian Richard Meyer, he compared it directly to Cecil Beaton's of Queen Elizabeth's coronation in 1953. I think it also, though, there's something about it for me that also recalls kind of the photographs of our parents or our grandparents that we might be more used to seeing placed neatly on a lace doily in a sitting room, on a fireplace, something like that. However, unlike those photographs of our grandparents, these are, or indeed Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip, these are both men. They're both dressed in leather. And interestingly, it's their clothes rather than their gender that signifies their role within their relationship, within a sadomasochistic relationship in which one is submissive and one is dominant. One stands, one is seated, one is chained to the other. But again, I think they both appear dominant in the face of the camera. They both direct the viewer with a very strong gaze. And this, when it's put in a domestic setting, it very much evokes power, and ownership, control over this space, this domestic environment. And the room, of course, is very well put together. There's lavish furnishings, there's expensive textiles and carpets. And in one sense, it appears quite an ordinary living room, though a very kind of upper-class one. But there's hints of underlying violence in that. If you look at the antlers that form this last table, so the antlers with this glass top resting possibly precariously on top of it. And that subtle sense of violence, I think, underneath this veneer of respectable domestic furnishings, and kind of upper-class taste. If you think about this in the late 1970s, the role that it might play then, it points to much wider cultural anxieties about what gay men do with each other at home, about what gay men do behind closed doors. Consensual sex between men in the privacy of their own homes, not legalized, was not constitutionally legal in the United States until 2003. There was a very important legal case that was heard before the Supreme Court in 1986 called Bowers versus Hardwick, which actually underscored the illegality of sex between men in private homes. In that case, in 1986, so quite a few years after this image, the Supreme Court found that the Constitution, with all of its freedoms, did not uphold the right of one man to fuck another man in the privacy of his own home. This is a photograph by Mapplethorpe of Mark Stevens, who was a very important, quite groundbreaking porn star in New York in the 1970s and the 1980s. Again, this is a highly staged image. So it presents S&M sex, I think, very much as highly theatrical, as highly stylized, as performed in accordance with a very clear set of rules in a very specific set of places. Although these are erotic in one sense because we see penises and sexual acts, they're not images of wild sexual abandon. They're representations of a very coded sexual subculture, and their highly ordered compositions reflect that. Interestingly, in this work, I think Mapplethorpe kind of simultaneously emphasized this masculine sexual power and dominance and subverts it. So even though the title tells us this is not just Mark Stevens, this is Mr. Ten and a Half, he appears very vulnerable. He's set out on this plinth here like a piece of meat that's about to be sliced. And we can see his bare ass looks like it might be about to be penetrated. It's kind of cut off by the composition. We don't quite know what's about to happen to that, but we know that his bare ass is open to penetration. So Mapplethorpe then, as he composes the image like this, as he's playing with kind of the sexual dynamics of S&M much more broadly, with the shifting relationship between power and vulnerability, dominance and submission. The cropping of the composition, I think, adds to the eroticism, because we don't really know who this man is, and we don't know what's about to happen to him, whether it's sexual or violent or a bit of both. And this uncertainty is what a lot of critics have argued is one of the things that made this image, among Mapplethorpe's others, so susceptible to controversy and to censorship. Because it's cropped and there's a lot of questions left unanswered, we start to answer those questions in our mind. And we start to we complete the scene and visualize it in our minds. So this is a work by another photographer, Peter Hujar. I think that compared to the work of Peter Hujar, who's another photographer who works in New York and specialized in portraits and took a number of erotic photographs, I'm often struck by, when you compare the two, how non-sexual, actually, Mapplethorpe's works appeared. Mapplethorpe's photographs of men's bodies are highly staged, they're shot in a studio, they're black and white as well, they have this kind of high art sensibility, sort of an historical aesthetic. And Mapplethorpe himself described his work as an effort to, I'm quoting here, turn faggot art into high art, that's what he called it. And his work is grand and it has gravitas, I think we could assume. But we get little of the experience of real sex in his work. There's not really any sort of smell or texture or feel to it, which I think makes it even more interesting that his work, as they'll kind of come on to, was so heavily censored. And the art historian Richard Meyer, who I mentioned before, he argued that the censorship of Mapplethorpe's work is actually what has increased its erotic potency, because censorship produces visual representations in our mind. It kind of leaves sexually suggestive images running wild in our imagination. So we see a similar sort of objectification, I think, in Mapplethorpe's work here that I talked about before, about this relationship between subject and object. But there's there's a lot that's problematic for me about Mapplethorpe's images of black men. And as he positions the figure on a plinth, a kind of plinth in his studio, it seems that he's quite literally turning the body of a person into an object, into a sort of sculpture. The figure in this image, we're given his name, Bob, he does not fix us with the same powerful gaze that we get from Brian or Lyle or Tim or John. Tom, sorry. And the American artist Glenn Ligon, he was very troubled by this. He was troubled by how Mapplethorpe's images of black men were presented and how they appeared to him decontextualized. He was troubled by the fact that in Mapplethorpe's photographs, we don't get any question really other than a first name of who these people are, why they're here. Are they only here for our visual delight? Are they only being photographed for our sexual pleasure? And so in response to Mapplethorpe's lack, Glenn Ligon produced a very large installation work which brought together Mapplethorpe's original images with lots of different textual commentary on both the images themselves from the mainstream press, but also quotations about black masculinity more broadly that he'd taken from novelists, from philosophers, from religious figures, but he also showed these photographs to friends of his in bars and at his house who weren't familiar with the art history of Mapplethorpe and see what they thought. So he wanted to create a context in which these works could be understood. It was very important to him to frame these decontextualized images of naked black men through text and offering a kind of notes on the margin as himself, a black gay man in America in the 1980s and 1990s. So this is one way I think it's important to recognize that artists were actually trying to challenge what we might call the white supremacist dynamic of the photographer and photographer subject that is actually at play in quite a lot of Mapplethorpe's work. And he's doing that through not producing new images, but through the addition of text, and kind of challenging the power of the image through language. So Mapplethorpe also took photographs of himself engaged in sadomasochistic sex and in private solo pleasure. Is based on the erotic experience of pain. And these images also shape, in different ways to the photographs of others, the relationship between, how we see the relationship between the sitter and the subject and the viewer, and also about the relationship more generally about seeing and being seen. This is a particularly interesting work in terms of Mapplethorpe's work being about photography and not just about sex, but about the act of being photographed. Because we're uncomfortably connected to Mapplethorpe through this bullwhip cord that extends from his ass out the frame towards the viewer. So the cord of the whip extends out to us. Might we not, we suggest, see that bullwhip as a metaphor for the act of taking a self-portrait, so a reference to the apparatus of photography? So it seems, if you think about it, like a stand-in for the sort of cord that more traditionally might tie the Mapplethorpe to the camera and that he would click to take a photograph of himself. The fact that he stages this so visibly as a self-portrait reminds us as well that this sex, or this kind of erotic act, is occurring within this very prepared and organized space of the studio, with very white walls and furniture draped in fabric and varnished floorboards, and very well lit. So the fact, it emphasizes the fact that Mapplethorpe is the way that he presents himself here as both the photographer and the subject of the photography, emphasizes that as he penetrates himself, he's both the agent and the recipient of this sexual act. So he's both, if you'll forgive me saying this phrase repeatedly, he's both fucker and fucked, okay? So the work might be referred to then as sort of referring to the procedure of making a self-portrait, being a productive subject and also being a receptive object. But importantly, I think, Mapplethorpe sets up a very confrontational scenario. So he's looking at us very aggressively. I will take any excuse to plug Peter Hujara's photography, but I think this comparison in terms of self-portraiture and erotic self-portraiture is a really important one. In this image, I think, a self-portrait of Peter Hujar in a gay bathhouse, he invites the viewer in, and we become sort of passers-by in the bathhouse, cruising for sex, possibly picking up Hujar. And this image then, the way that invites the viewer in, it becomes much more collaborative.
rather than confrontational, which is what we see very much here.
Mapplethorpe's self-portraits and the way that they've kind of been discussed more recently, they're very much about registering his presence, and the presence of erotic subjects in the face of political controversy and censorship. So he was documenting the subculture and documenting himself engaging in it at a time while it was being censored, at a time where a lot of this was illegal. And I think in this photograph, as I was saying, he confronts us as viewers. He's also confronting and kind of basing censors as well. This is an advert, sorry, it's a bit pixelated, for an exhibition that he held at an alternative art space, 89th Street in San Francisco, because this series of works had been removed from a commercial exhibition. So he decided to hold two exhibitions simultaneously in 1987 in San Francisco, and people would go to both of them, which is quite interesting. He kind of intended them to be confrontational, but actually people attended both. And so he was bringing together this sort of high art scene and also this high erotic scene of S&M leather culture, because this alternative art space was in Folsom Street, in the heart of San Francisco's leather culture. This is a work that I also wanted to mention just in relation to the censorship of Mapplethorpe's work. It's another work by Glenn Ligon from 1993. This is a series of works, Red Portfolio. What Glenn Ligon did with this series is he appropriated the politician, Senator Jesse Helms, who kind of led the censorship, the attack on Mapplethorpe's work. And what he did was he took descriptions that Helms had written of work by Mapplethorpe that he felt should be censored or deprived of any state funding. So this one says a photo of a man in a suit exposing himself. So Ligon was transforming then powerful words, powerful images into words. But he was also pointing to, quite interesting, this huge gulf that exists between words and images, between graphic and explicit imagery, and between graphic and explicit language. We have to go quite close to the image, actually, when they're displayed to read them. The text is so small. And as we look at them, we end up, as I said, visualizing the scene in our minds. It becomes an image in our minds, in our imagination. But interestingly, because these are words rather than images, they enjoy a very special protection in the United States in a legal sense. So words have First Amendment protection where images do not. So it's perfectly legal to talk about a photo of a man in a suit exposing himself and visualize it imaginatively. It's not permissible to look at it. Interestingly, I think a lot of this controversy around censorship surfaced as Mapplethorpe himself was dying and was slipping from life's view. So that seemed to, for a lot of the censors, seemed to kind of emphasize that these images were disgusting and they were sickly and deadly, they were things that we shouldn't be looking at. But the censorship controversy, as he was dying, the fact that this was happening then, it kept Mapplethorpe, kept interest in Mapplethorpe's work alive. And this is comparable, I think, to that idea that actually what censorship does is heightens the kind of visualization of these images. It encourages us to produce erotic images in our mind rather than getting rid of them entirely. This is something that's happening in terms of Mapplethorpe's life himself.
And after Mapplethorpe's death,
as he'd experienced a queer sort of kind of professional erasure when the Perfect Moment exhibition in Washington was cancelled. This was after his death. He died in March 1989. And this is an image from June 1989. This was a protest against the closure of the exhibition at the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, where he appears almost like a ghost. This is that first self-portrait that I showed you. He appears sort of ghost-like on the exterior. So the exhibition that was inside was censored, but protesters projected him on the outside. And this censorship of Mapplethorpe's work is very much part of its history and legacy. In fact, he's often, in an art historical context, a sort of academic context, he's only really studied in this sense. It's quite difficult, really, to talk about his depictions of nudity and sex without discussing the censorship that came with them. So it's a lot, I think, for contemporary artists to deal with, how to deal with this loaded legacy. And this is one of my favourite examples of how contemporary artists have kind of sought to engage with Mapplethorpe's work, Mapplethorpe himself, and with his censorship. So this is a still from a short video work by the artist James Richards, which was nominated for the Turner Prize in 2013. And among other things, it explores Richards' strange encounters with library books in Tokyo, where when he went to look at books about Mapplethorpe's work, he found that all of the sexual, all kind of genitalia things had been scratched out to comply with Japanese censorship laws. And what we're left with instead, in the place of where a cock should be, we're left with this kind of ghostly gap that's quite horrifying, it's quite disturbing, but also, like all censorship does, I think, and more specifically in relation to Mapplethorpe's work, it leaves it much more open then to fantasy and to imagination.
Or looking at it kind of as a kind of very easily produced So I think that's a consideration. There is something quite senior about it.
Yeah.
I can't remember the original image. This is darker than I remember. So I don't know, that's just another plot.
Maybe it
acquires
a seediness in reproduction.
Maybe, especially in a small format. Because mm-hmm. you know, on a gallery wall, it becomes something of this sort of, I don't know, you don't want me to go too far back into aesthetic contemplation. Particularly nowadays, when all map portals become so recuperated as a sort of guarantor of liberalness amongst more conservative institutions, that it's this acceptable way of people doing it. Remember, these images on the screen that come up, we're going to sit in London and stuff. Yeah. And I think there's something different about that kind of small format to keep the screen closed.
I think it's quite interesting that you mentioned that, because you know the first image that I talked that I had up just as a kind of holding slide, and Susan mentioned this as part of his practice much earlier when he was making these small sculptures in which he incorporates pornographic images or images from pornographic magazines and small Polaroids of himself. They take on the character of like private devotional objects, which, like you said, these kind of photographs do, which gives them a different eroticism or a different. We contemplate them differently when we see them in this small format, very much. Yeah. It's also, we're familiar with seeing erotic images painted, we're familiar with seeing a popular treatment for artists in scenes of brothels or rape, both literal and metaphorical. This is something that we're familiar with seeing in the National Gallery. So I think it's interesting how it becomes seedy. When size becomes important, I don't mean that flippantly.
I mean, photography as a medium was fundamental to the rise of mass circulation of pornographic imaging, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the postcard, I guess that's what you're thinking about as well. That sort of that kind of format has a particular. Value in that sort of scene.
Could I just say one thing? Susan mentioned Sam Wagstaff, who was for a time Mapplethorpe's lover, close friends for many decades, two decades, who was a great collector of photography and played a very important role in the perception of photography as of an art form rather than just as documentation. So that is really interesting that Mapplethorpe had that had a patron like that who bought him a studio, who paid for a lot of his work, who paid for a lot of his materials. It's not just that Mapplethorpe was interested in himself in making his own work appear like high art, but he was also interested much more broadly in encouraging Wagstaff to view photography as high art, which he hadn't actually done until he met Mapplethorpe. But it was Mapplethorpe that encouraged him to collect photography.
Just one more point from what Harry was saying, just about the format of Mapplethorpe's printed and exhibited work. I mean, is there something to be said about that? Is there?
Yeah, I mean, the context that you're going to see something in affects very much how you look at it and what you're going to question about it. So if it's in a book amongst, you know, several images, are you going to take the time to contemplate the same questions? Whereas I think the setting of the gallery wall, it very much changes it. And we do pose those questions as to, is this erotic? Or is this, you know, occupying a different area of art? So I think that probably, yeah, the gallery setting is where you're really going to pose that. And it is very interesting.
In terms of the printing of his work, printing and exhibiting of, you know, his work and sale of print, I mean, in terms of sort of format size, was there a consistent format size, or, I mean, are they sort of cabinet-sized pictures like this, mostly, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I think that they do follow, a consistent format.
Yeah.
Although I'm not really sure if that was very much thought out, if we had a kind of standard that he followed along, didn't
I? Well, with a lot of the images that I showed, they were part of, they were smaller, because they were not intended as kind of gallery, exhibited in the gallery, they were much more private or part of the smaller portfolios of erotic images. Mm-hmm. But in the perfect moment, a lot of them are going to be displayed in cabinets, you know, kind of looking at them from above rather than hanging on a wall. So they were seen as separate in terms of the way that they were printed as well. I think most of the others that you talked about, there's a standard format for him. But I don't know whether that was an aesthetic decision or just a practical one.
And he printed his own work all the time?
I don't know, actually.
I don't know if anyone knows that.
He didn't actually develop them a lot himself. The reason he was so drawn to photography was because of that very difficult nature to it, and that he didn't want to lose a moment. So the more kind of layered process of developing, he wasn't actually as attached to. So as far as I know, he didn't really engage with that as much.
Any other thoughts from any time?
Just to return to the discussion about using art and discipline involved around the aesthetics and narratives and to draw the inclusiveness and this kind of intrinsic way in which sexuality and action those kind of hidden issues have to be displayed artistically and physically. So that's sort of
actually funny, I'm going a bit off pace here, but just you mentioning George O'Keefe, I saw recently Digby Animating went for a record price of auction, and on the American news, it was a nude on a couch, and it was censored, and they actually blurred out all the kind of private bits, whereas on the British news it wasn't, but I saw the American TV presenter talking about it, and the censorship in art, particularly on American stations, and he used George O'Keefe as an example, and he was like, but I can show this work, and it was one of her paintings, and so I think it's very interesting, sorry, as I said, that was a bit of an aside, but as you say, this kind of eroticism and, you know, kind of reflection to genitalia, which it seems that if you just say or describe a flower work, it's not going to be as obvious, but as you mentioned, that hitting is very erotic and it does have that connotation. So it's an interesting parallel, just the different ways that it can be visual, if not immediately or on discussion.
And I think, you know, Mapplethorpe would be very aware of O'Keefe's work, but also of the prevalence in 1970s feminist practice of what was called central core imagery, so vaginal genital imagery, which was suggestive, not even as directly as looking at a flower and seeing it as kind of sexual. So I think that's something that from even primary school biology we're sort of familiar with, but artists like Judy Chicago were suggesting it through much more metaphorical means, like just through paintings that appear in the abstract, not just an image of a flower that's eroticized. So I think he's operating, I see him very much as inspired by, informed by that kind of feminist central core imagery.
I mean, one of the things I wondered about as well was how you situate Mapplethorpe in relation to the history of American photography. So you know, obviously O'Keefe both made his photographs and was photographed a lot by Stevens, and there are you know, Edward Weston's photographs of Neil, of a young boy, sort of making torso. There's a certain kind of history of bodily representation in American photography, and again because of this, I suppose the S&M and the censorship, the way that dominates the landscape, as you were saying, Fiona, maybe he doesn't get situated in relation to those things so much.
I think that's interesting, because the reason that I decided not to show this work, and maybe it was silly not to show it, but one of the photographs that was most controversial in the Perfect Moment exhibition was a photograph of a 7-year-old son of a friend, of the artist Judy Lynn, a friend of Mapplethorpe's, so a boy, Jesse McBride, 7 years old. Senator Jesse Helms is proudly displaying his penis. Not that he had that much to show at 7 years old, but he's just kind of playfully running about naked. And what a lot of the censors or potential censors saw in that image was they saw parallels between Mapplethorpe's photographs of young boys and young girls, which I see as totally innocent and just friendly, and his images of sadomasochism. They didn't see that in the tradition of, like I said, Edward Weston's photographs of his son. Those kind of nude photographs, which are at the very beginning of American photography as a discipline. So I think that's really striking, partly because, as I alluded to before, Mapplethorpe isn't just working in that tradition, he's also a fundamentally important figure in the founding of that tradition and in the fact that people were collecting American photography and seeing photography as important, because he really encouraged Wagstaff to collect photography and lots of other people in America in the 70s and 80s to collect photography. So that makes it even more shocking to me that he's not seen in that trajectory. The fact is, it aids, I think, it causes people to see a relationship between his photographs of young naked children and his photographs of much older naked men and women. They see that causal relation. It's kind of it infects the discourse around his photography.
Is anyone else
concerned?
Yeah.
Sorry,
I
was
going to
talk about the power
very insistent on this. So it's not class, it's not globalization, it's was very focused on that as a question. And I suppose when we think about the context in the United States, you've mentioned obviously that particular history of Black Americans and representation of Black Americans and also for slave trade and so on, that it's hard to grasp the charged nature as well of those images, isn't it? That they have a very particular currency in that moment and have a very particular intensity, I guess, those images. Which, you know, and I guess now with historical hindsight, we can see some of the problematic nature of that more clearly, but at the time, I think they were extremely confrontational. Yes?
Just on that question of racism in the world, without a particular racial earlier, where the man is looking down, he's not actually looking out.
That one.
If not, we thank our speakers.